Today, we're making a dish that has been twice voted as the number one dish in the world by CNN opinion polls, has caused cultural wars between countries over its origin, but most importantly, a tasty dish that is beloved by all. Today, we're making beef rendang. What is rendang? Well, it's actually not a dish itself, but a name given to the end product of something processed through the method of merendang, a West Sumatra way of preserving meat by first boiling, then frying. So even though today we're using beef, one of the earliest cookbooks I could find documenting this dish actually used chicken. So in this video, more so I want to explore this wonderful method of processing meat to the best of our ability, staying as close to the original recipes as possible. And in the coming weeks, we'll play around and adopt it for the home kitchen. So first things first, we make the boiling liquid. We gently heat up an extremely generous amount of coconut milk. While modern day adaptation of the dish often calls for the frying of the paste and sometimes even the meat, the older recipes from around the 1600s and 1700s always call for liquid first. So we bring some heat, gentle heat that is, to not separate the coconut fat from the coconut milk.
At least not yet.
While that's slowly boiling, we make our pemasek, the mix of ground spices and aromatic vegetables. And for that, of course, we enlist our pestle and mortar. First up, we add some ginger. From my limited understanding, ginger and garlic and shallots are chosen for their preservation capabilities more so than their flavors,
as the West Sumatra
people would carry their rendang and travel for weeks, sometimes months, and without refrigerators, they need something that could keep for the duration of their travels. And that's why, from all accounts, a real rendang back in the olden days has a texture much closer to beef jerky than a modern day curry. And today we're keeping the ingredients extremely simple. Of course, later on when we try to develop our own recipes, we can play with the spices, with garlic. If you're using dry chilies, by the way, add them before the wet ingredients. We'll keep everything close to a 1-to-1 ratio. It's fascinating to me how different cultures use different methods to extract the most from their aromatic vegetables. In Southeast Asia, it's often pounding. In classic French cooking, it's more so the sweating. But the objective of the exercise remains flavor extraction. We pound as we prep. And we salt, not just to season, but to provide some friction for the aromatic vegetables. Next up, add some shallots. Lemongrass. We remove the tough outer leaves. Next up, we have some galangal, and just like the ginger,
even though they do not taste anything alike,
you remove the tough outer skin. And the chili. There are recipes that use
dry, recipes that use
fresh. So today we're just doing whatever is convenient. And to maximize flavor extraction from the chilies,
I always recommend you remove
the seeds, and if you want it spicier, add more chilies. Our hands, and now we pound this down into a paste. Now we have an extremely fine paste, and we'll incorporate this paste into our coconut milk. Now, traditionally, turmeric leaves are also added, but it's extremely, extremely difficult to find. For me, the taste profile, it's similar to a crossbreed between curry leaves and bay leaves. So in that spirit, and to pay homage to the Indian influence of this dish, we add a bit of fresh curry leaves. And now we taste and adjust for seasoning, bearing in mind the fact that this will be reduced. And now the beef goes in for the first stage of merendang, the boiling. Now, the choice of beef today is topside, which is a very lean braising joint that requires slow cooking. And most beef rendang nowadays still use very lean joints. And you'll see the reason why very shortly. So now, give everything a mix. Once this is close to boiling, we lower the heat to medium and we let this simmer without the lid so that two things occur at the same time. One, the slow poaching would A, cook the meat, B, break down the tough collagen and connective tissues into extremely yummy gelatin. But secondly, we are evaporating the water content of the coconut milk so that towards the end of cooking, All that's left is the solids from the coconut milk and the natural coconut fat, which is what's going to enable the second stage of the merendang process, the frying. And that's the cleverness of the choice of lean meat. Because they use such a huge amount of coconut milk, it will naturally bring a lot of fat to the dish. And to balance that amount of fat, the lean meat suddenly seems the perfect choice. So we take this journey together. I'll leave the camera on throughout the duration of the reduction. And in about 2 to 3 hours, we'll fry some beef. I'll see you then. After about 3 hours, I'm changing to a t-shirt in anticipation of the next stage. This is what we have. As we've explained earlier, most of the water content from the coconut milk has been evaporated and the oil has split. And now we're in essence shallow frying the now tender beef, the solids from the coconut milk, and the flavors and paste we've made. So now we go. And from any literature, traditionally, this dish is extremely, extremely dark, and we'll try our best to achieve that without burning the bottom of the pan. That's another clever thing of the dish, is that the sugar content from the shallots, from the garlic, along with the protein from the beef, can now enjoy the Maillard reaction. What's going to make this dish taste extremely meaty? I mean, there's a reason why this dish is now refined, I suppose, given the insanely long active cooking time. Besides the beginning, I have not left the stove because I had to keep stirring. And the amazing thing is when we started, we had a pot that's practically white, and now it's taken on so much color without the need for any colorful ingredients. This is all mild and gentle caramelization. Why we wear a t-shirt. I now have a better understanding of its preserving capabilities given the amount of natural oil. This is almost a semi-confit in a way. This dish is a proper workout. The smell, it's incredible. The complexity of this dish really comes down to the cooking method, not the ingredients. Back in the olden days, without non-stick, this must have been extra hard. But I suppose if you cook them in batches, they would end up with so much coconut oil that this stage might feel closer to deep frying at low heat. I know I've said it many times, but it's genius that they use lean meat. This looks very lean, but there's probably a full cup or two of coconut oil incorporated in it. This has got to be one of the most labor-intensive dishes we've ever done on this channel. And you really can't leave it because it's gonna burn immediately. I almost worry that we've taken this as far as this pot would allow me without burning. But you can smell this wonderful caramelization, and I feel the more we do it, the more flavors we develop. So let's keep going. I'm for your afternoon, are you? Basically, every time I turn up the heat, I get punished with slight burn bits at the bottom. But every time I reduce the heat back to low, the moisture released from the aromatic vegetables was sufficient to scrape them off. So it really mandates low heat. I almost want to cook a steak after this. Just to go to the other end of the spectrum. The smell, this is incredible. If anyone wants to repeat this at home, I highly recommend that you pretend non-stick technology was available back in the 1600s. I know we said I'm gonna domesticate this for the home kitchen. Just by smelling it, I don't know what we're gonna do to develop such complexity. Wow. All right, I think this is as beautiful a dark brown color as it gets before it turns blackish, which is what some recipes describe. But I think for the sake of my right arm, we stop here. And after that much hard work, I think we deserve a taste. Wow, the smell is really hard to describe. I know I'm repeating myself. This has the most wonderful sense of coconuttiness, if that's a word, through the slow caramelization and reduction and cooking of the solids from the coconut milk with the coconut oil. It's incredible. The flavor profile is so well balanced, rich, but not heavy. Spicy, sweet, salty, full of umami. The taste is lingering in the mouth. It is one of the most incredible things I've ever tasted. Let's plate one, shall we? Truly, wow. Labor of love. Look how dry this is in the nicest way. Wow. And that's it. A true testament to the West Sumatra culture, blending different influences from the Dutch, from the Portuguese, from Islam, from the Indians, from the Malays. This is one of the tastiest things I've had the pleasure to cook and taste This is rendang. I really, really hope you enjoy. Wow. It's insane.